First of all, I gotta say this. You know, it is a blessing. It is a blessing. I know I echo myself a lot. I know that happens after 50. We repeat ourselves a lot. But, and I'm noticing that lately, you know, more and more and more. I have to say that it is a blessing and an honor to open God's word with you and see God's wisdom as we gather together as God's elect to sit, hear, learn what the Spirit has to say to the church this morning. And I get really excited because, you know what, there's nothing in this life that can excite me more than the word of God, and that should be the same for you guys. So if I can translate, if I can be a mediator for the Holy Spirit to speak to you, may that be this morning. So I love you guys first and foremost. I'm pretty loving. If you know me by now, you know, I'm the hugger kind of guy, you know. I want to make sure that you feel God's love through me. So, you know, it is a blessing. And again, it's an honor. It's an honor to be here. So I know you heard it already. And again, you know, after 50, you repeat yourself. Happy Father's Day again. Okay, so just so you don't forget, today's Father's Day, you know, and it's, and as many have said, Father's Day, it is just like Mother's Day, except it's less expensive, you know, which is, you know, and it's very true, you know. Anyways, I'm not going to get into what we spend for Mother's Day, but it was expensive. But anyways, you know, just an FYI. But you know what, today, I think we want to focus on what God wants to speak to men. Not to say that God will not speak, as Pastor Connor just mentioned, to everyone here. Because we serve a Heavenly Father. And just the same message as He has for men, has for women. We want to play a different role in God's church. And we want to develop that role to grow. Oh, we're going to get to that soon enough. Because we're going to be talking about discipline. Yeah, I know, that's pretty funny. But that's what my grandma looked like. So, we all play a special role in God's, you know, family. Every single one of us. And you, I mean, check out the DNA. No one in this world will have or has ever had the same DNA as you and me. What does that mean? God has created you and me special to do something that no one will ever do just like you. So think about that. Think about how special you are before God. So it's a blessing. So Father's Day again, you know, not as expensive as Mother's Day, but you know what? Here we are. So today's Father's Day. You know, just before we move on, by a raise of hands, who is a father here? Can you guys raise your hands? Oh, man. Jesus sees your hands. Thank you for what you're doing in your children's lives. Thank you. Because of you, a lot of us are here. So thank God for everything you do, you know, for me to even being here. As most of you know, statistically speaking, today is the least attended day in church. You know what? Maybe somewhere else, but it ain't here. So praise God for you. Thank you for being here. So even though we're speaking to fathers, God's word is, again, another echo, always applies to all of us in one way, shape, or form. So this message is for all of us. Again, I told you the statistics, you know, the lowest church attendance. So again, congratulate you parents for being here. You could have been out at the beach or doing whatever, but this actually speaks volumes of your value before God. And if you're here visiting for the first time, well, thank God you're here. And I just pray that our Heavenly Father speaks to your heart. Now, I was kind of going through all over Google and kind of investigating how things have changed, you know, as far as fathers. We live in a time and an age and day to which we've encountered, at least in my lifetime, you know, 53 years old, have seen many, many changes from then and now, and we continually see changes when it comes to the role of a father. Every single day that we live here, it has lost to a certain degree from what it seems its value. If you guys, I don't know, a lot of you guys from the 1950s, there's a few of you guys out there. You know, 60s, yeah, there's a few of you too. If you guys remember back in those days, fatherhood looked a lot different. It was portrayed in a different way than it is today. As a matter of fact, has anybody seen or heard the show Father Knows Best? You guys remember that? Robert Young? Anybody? And you know, maybe you're a youngster and you might have seen some reruns and stuff, but back in those days, that's the way. I mean, this guy, if you remember, he was always wearing a tie all the time. Remember? Didn't matter if it was in the garage, he was wearing the tie. It didn't matter if it was working in his car. Have you guys ever paid attention to that? You know why? Because he was portrayed as a father that knew, that had all the answers. He was always right. I mean, the role that was given to a father does not compare to the role that is given to a father today. That guy knew it all. As a matter of fact, if you remember, like, Leave It to Beaver, remember those shows too? Man, I love those old shows. And you would hear all these, you know, mama would say, oh, wait till your father gets home. He's got a solution for everything. And it was true. Fathers were heroes. Fathers, you know, were respected. Fathers were honored. As most of you that lived in the 1960s and 50s, you know, and live here today, it's not the same anymore. Those values have been lost or maybe forgotten. You know, I've heard a saying, and I don't know the author, so forgive me for that, but, and it says this, and I quote, "It is much easier to build a boy than to repair a man. It is much easier to build a boy than to repair a man." I hope this sinks down into you guys' hearts. Why? Because God has called us to reach the next generation. And how we do that isn't based on one day or a single Father's Day. It is actually based on everyday living. To what we do in the light, to what we do in the darkness, to what we do when everyone's watching, to what we do when no one's watching. I hope you guys realize that, because it will change the next generation. So it is much easier to build a boy than to repair a man. There's also another saying that says, I quote, "It only takes a minute or minutes to be a father, but a lifetime to be a dad." And that speaks volumes to the same thing that I'm saying. So these things are important. You know, we live in a world that at one time, I don't know, let me take you back to, boy, 1984. That was a long time ago, huh, for some of us. For some of you, not long enough. If you guys remember 1984, Bill Cosby, remember that guy? He was portrayed as America's favorite dad. Maybe you guys remember that? Well, if that is the kind of dad that America has as a favorite dad, you know where he's at and you know why he's there. He's in prison. From generation to generation, even not just back from 1984 till now, but, you know, dads have been portrayed as a weak man. As a father, if you watch any TV show, which, you know, I don't recommend, there's, you know, it used to be fun to watch TV. I remember when I was a kid, black and white TV came out. Man, you know, we didn't have one, but the neighbors did. So the window was packed with a bunch of kids looking at, you know, TV shows. I was one of those. Man, it was awesome to watch TV. As a matter of fact, we've used that as a bargaining chip, remember? Our kids, if you don't do your chores, you ain't watching TV. So when we watch TV, you know, it was exciting to watch it because we learn stuff. There's nothing good on TV anymore, but today in TV, as fathers, they're portrayed as clueless, irresponsible, and even childish. You've seen that? In this day and age, we have a desperate need for godly dads. We as dads have a great responsibility in influencing our children. Part of this reason is so important that we live in a society that increasingly devalues masculinity and manhood, or dads. It would not be an exaggeration to say that the manhood and the family order established by God is under attack. And it's certainly being redefined by our culture. It may consist of father and mother or two men and a child, or two women and a child. This is portrayed as a perfectly normal, healthy families. Well, let me tell you, that is far from the truth. Going back to Genesis, going back to God's perfect plan of creation, man and women, we are losing that. Which is, again, let me say one more time. We live in a day and age till we are desperate for godly dads. Desperate. We need you guys to take your role. And as we continually, we'll get into the word, as Moses is worried that this will not be communicated to our children. Single moms, you have the same responsibility as us dads. You know, I love you guys for, you know, I can only imagine how hard it is for you guys, single moms. But you know what? We serve a God that is gracious. We serve a God that will give you the tools to do that which he has called you to do. Amen. And I thank God for that. I thank God for that. We are desperate, in desperate need for godly dads. We have a great responsibility in influencing our children. Again, we live in a society that increasingly devalues masculinity, manhood, or dads. So it is not an exaggeration to say that families established by God are under attack and certainly been redefined, as we already mentioned. We see this not only on a day-to-day basis, but again on TV. As many shows, a father's portrayed as, again, as immature boys, and even worse, this is a serious problem. The reality that we face today is that God's image in man is being attacked. Why? Why are we seeing this more and more? I truly believe that somewhere along the way or along the line, we as men have stopped taking our role given by God seriously and have stopped being an influence to our children and even walked away from their lives. The family continues to be under attack. And one of the biggest crises that assaults the family comes from fatherless families. And it's growing more and more. I was reading a report out of Prison Fellowship. I don't know if you guys ever heard of them, but what they are is it's a ministry that actually goes to prisons and gives out mothers' cards, so does Father's Day's cards, so that the inmates can send them to their fathers and mothers. And they reported something that was interesting to me. In this particular prison, during Mother's Day, there was a request for 1,000 Mother's Day cards. And in the same prison, when Father's Day came along, there was a request for 6 Father's Day cards. Statistically, you think about that, and this is heartbreaking. This is heartbreaking because the role that God has established in men and you and me has been broken, forgotten. And I think as parents, our concern should be, as Moses is concerned, that we communicate the importance of godly dads to our children. You know, I have to say that by no means, you know, when we look at the word and we feel convicted of what God reveals to us, I need to say that by no means we are parading father's failures, because we all have them. We can all be better dads. You know, this is about raising the banner of what a biblical father looks like. And by God's grace and by his spirit, I want to encourage you and tell you that we can do this. We can. And that's coming from a man that did not have a dad. I did not have a father. I met my dad when I was 17 years old. I had an absent mother for my whole life. So there's a lot of things I can't tell you. But everything I've learned as a father, I have learned it from my Heavenly Father. That's what I'm talking about. We can do this. You guys can do this. God has given us, to me, I have five generations. Man, I see my kids and I go, whoa. You know, because I don't know if you notice, but you can see yourself and your kids, right? Sometimes you go, uh-oh. I know I do. I go, good job, you know. But other times it's like, man, I don't know who that kid is. Never seen the man. We see ourselves in our kids. So God, you can see the responsibility that God has given you guys. You know, you heard the expression, he looks just like his dad. I mean, I use that many, many times. So again, so don't feel bad. But at the same time, if God is speaking to you, then this is great. So we're not parading your failures or mine. I'm just saying that we can change the next generation. So remember that. With God, it's never too late. You know, we serve a God that, oh man, his blessings are new every year. Every morning. I hope you didn't think it was every year because then you're in trouble. Every morning. His blessings are new every morning. And even as a dad, it's the same promise to you and me. So we want to raise the banner of what a biblical father looks like. And by God's grace and his spirit, again, we can do this. Now, I'm going to bore you with some statistics. Because we live in a country that continues to walk in disobedience to God and what pertains to God himself. We walk in disobedience. Did you know that census.gov, and I'm sure this is being said or portrayed to me through many churches, but this is what it says. Census.gov declares that in the U.S., as of March 21st, 2024, which is actually a National Single Parent Day, is what they call it, March 21st, 2024, it says that out of the current, there's a survey on the current population. Child Protective Services says this. They estimate that out of 9.8 million people, or out of the world's population, 9.8 million are one-parent household. Man, you know, I see that and I go, man, Lord, it breaks my heart. 7.3 million are mothers only. So 9.8 million population, 7.3 million. Our mothers only, 2.5, our fathers only. This is as of 2023. The statistics are heartbreaking and are only increasing day by day. So let me share more statistics that might, you know, shine a little more light on this. 63% of youth suicides are from fatherless homes. 90% of all runaway children are from fatherless homes. 85% have behavior disorders and are from fatherless homes. 71% of high school dropouts are from fatherless homes. 75% of drug abuse children are from fatherless homes. And 85% of youths in prison are from fatherless homes. This paints a perfect picture of the great need and responsibility that we have as fathers and mothers. And I have to, I think it's important to mention to mothers, you know, the mother's role is very important. It's not Mother's Day, so I'm going to give you this one for free. It's not Mother's Day, but a mother's role is very, very important. It is not a matter of who's being more important than other. What it is a matter of is that God has designed the roles to serve as father and mother in a complementary fashion. And together to reflect the nature and the person and the heart of God. In a way that neither role by itself can do. We complement each other. I don't know when was the last time you guys went through a marriage class. But, you know, we're not even going there because I can go out on the left field pretty quick. But we're different. Have you noticed? God's got a sense of humor. I got to marry her. But she, you know, she likes to spend, I like to save, you know. She's not as loud as me. Anyways, we're different, but God has a perfect plan. He takes two opposites, brings them together, and says, okay, work it out. We complement each other. And in that, you know, in addition to that, God gives us a responsibility of raising godly children. Which is a blessing. You know, it's an adventure. Every day, if you're a dad, it's an adventure. If you're not a dad yet, get ready. Because this adventure, forget hiking or going anywhere you go. Tell you what, being a dad, in the way that God has intended it, it is a blessing and it's an adventure every single day. So the mother's role, again, is always or will always be primarily in the terms of intimacy, care, and nurture. But the fact of the matter is that a child matures, as he or she matures, he or she will increasingly look to the father for their role in processing decisions and adopting values. Let me repeat that. It is a child, as a child matures, he or she will increasingly look to the father for their role in processing decisions and adopting values. Boys will look for their father's approval in everything they do. Girls will look for men that pattern their fathers. Scary, huh? But that's how it is. That's how it is. You know, I look at my daughter's husband, you know, and yeah, he looked kind of like, you know, had a few things. We had a few things in common. But when the father is indifferent or absent, the task of maturing in a responsible manner becomes much harder for the child. You know, again, I gave you a little short personal testimony. I did not know my dad till I was 17. And my mom, for the most part, was absent. So it's very difficult. I, you know, relate to those statistics that I just told you because it's very true. Not only that, but I work for an institution. You know, I get a front row seat. Seeing this every day, I have worked for this institution for 34 years. And we host over 12,000 of our city's children. 12,000. I see this in our meeting, the absence of dads, and the consequences that it brings as well from the absence of a father. We live in a time where there is a huge importance of being influential, godly fathers. With that, there are motives for obedience and being a godly father. Not only does it align the family in the order that God intended it to be, but it changes our cities, then our state, then our country, and ultimately it changes the world. That's how important this is. It is very vitally important. So fathers have a great responsibility before God in exercising our role. We will give a great impact, not only to our lives, but to our children's lives. You know, we all do parenting differently, right? I mean, you guys all come from, you know, I'm Hispanic. I was raised in Aguascalientes, un ranchito que se llama Altaray. But somewhere in Mexico. You know, we've all grown in different generations, so we do parenting differently. You know, because I was looking through Deuteronomy verses 1-9, I'm thinking, man, you know, that looks easy compared to what we had to go through. We do all parenting different. You know, primarily we parent how we see our dads do it, right? If you had a dad. Because of that, I can say that parenting looks different in every home, through every single one, even here. Even being from the same country, the same state, the same city, we all do parenting different. I can share what parenting looked like in my house. For example, just in the area of discipline, I was raised with the fear of a chancla. Now, we can go back to that image. Yeah, check that out. That's right. That was my grandma right there. She would do, man. Boy, you know what? I remember that. When we did something wrong, my grandma would give us two of those chanclazos. That's the way it sounds. That's why I don't clap that much. Because it reminds me, like, oh, man. You know, two of those, and all you needed was two of those to be alert for about a week. You know, because it the flashbacks and stuff. Where we lived in a little area, a little street. There was no pavement back in the 70s. I'm going back to 1974, 5. But right across my grandma's house, there's a big old fence made out of rock. And so it must have been maybe about 50 feet. Now, if you decided to run, you had 50 feet. you know what? I've learned to zigzag. Because my grandma would turn into Fernando Valenzuela, man. She raised that leg and, you know, there he goes. She was good. My sister's here. She remembers. Look at, she's twitching. Still remembers. My grandma was good at the chancla. So that's how I was raised. You know, we didn't try to run anymore. We just sit there. You know, maybe you were raised when it comes to discipline with the fear of the wooden spoon. Now check out the next image. Maybe, oh, I heard that. Oh, yeah, it still hurts. Yeah. So maybe you were disciplined and raised in this manner. You know, you were afraid of the wooden spoon. Or maybe the next image, you were raised or disciplined in a timeout fashion. Right? You guys remember that too? I remember all three of them. For us, the Bible at home has been exercised since the Lord saved us. And I remember my son, specifically Joshua. I remember his favorite verse. No, it's not his favorite verse, but the first verse he memorized. It was the one that says, "Hit him where the good Lord split him." No, it doesn't say that. Proverbs 13:24. Whoever spares the rod hates his son, but he who loves is diligent to discipline him. And my son was very loved. All my five boys were loved a lot. You know, but I have to say that to this day, I think Joshua still hears Proverbs 13:24, which is his password. No, I'm just messing. It's not. He gets, even our kids, they get really serious, you know. So that's how we live, that's how we discipline our children. Now, when it came to corporal punishment, I wasn't the one that did that. I think it was my wife. As a matter of fact, I know it was my wife. How I know? Because my kids know it. My wife loved to shop, as most of you women maybe like to shop too. And she'd take the kids with her, you know, Anthony, Eddie, Vivian, Chris, and Joshua. And she hit every store. You know, make sure they had all the right sales and stuff. And so in the store, as most of you that had your little kids, they wanted everything in the store. So obviously, they didn't get everything. But they would throw a little temper tantrum and stuff, and my wife would take them out to her favorite place. That was the restroom. Till this day, all my kids know all the square footage of every restroom. They know where it's at. They know the schematics. They got like a blueprint printed into their head. For me, all it took is the John Wayne look, you know. That's all. I didn't have to do anything. They saw me, you know, dads. Some dads are like that. They just that look. That's all it takes. Well, regardless of how we do parenting, God has a perfect way to do it, has a way for us to do it. And Moses was concerned that God's message would not be passed down to their children. So I think it is safe to say that we all know that it is our motive for obedience to God is to have his promises and blessings in our lives, our children's lives, while we live in this world, and ultimately leading us to eternity. And those motives for obedience should be an encouragement for us daily. As Hebrews 11:6 states clearly, God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Moses is concerned that God's message will not be passed down to their children, to the next generation. But if this was going to happen, the parents needed to internalize God's commandments first, allowing his word to become a vital part of every aspect of their lives. And so he starts in verses 1 to 3, and it says, "Now this is the commandment, that the statutes and the rules that the Lord your God commanded me to teach you, that you may do them in the land to which you are going over to possess it, that you may fear the Lord your God, you and your son and your son's son, by keeping the statutes and his commandments, which I command you all the days of your life, that your days may be long."
Hear therefore, O Israel, and be careful to do them, that it may go well with you, and that you may multiply greatly as the Lord, the God of your fathers, has promised to you in the land flowing with milk and honey. So the first promise, long life and keeping his law. You want to live a long life? Serve the Lord. Notice that there's a lot of yous in here. This is because it all starts with you, with me. Moses is saying that God must be first in our lives. He must first be our God. And that we must do. This applies to a lifestyle. Not simply what we do every Sunday, but it's talking about an identity. Christians is not what we do. Christians is who we are. And when we live that way, then our kids are watching us. They're watching every step we do. So Christianity is something we are, not something we do on Sundays or Wednesdays or whenever the church is open. That's who we are every day. Amen. We should be able to be identified outside. It doesn't matter where you're at. So it starts with us making God first our God. We must do, we must have a lifestyle. We are called to keep his law. Not just one day, but all the days of our lives. If we are to teach our children, we must be example for them to follow. Dads, you know, the way we live our lives, the way we lead our homes today matters. For this will affect our children. We have an effect in our marriage. We'll have an effect in our neighborhood. We'll have an effect in our city, our state, our country. And ultimately, we'll have an effect in our next generation. We desperately need to hear the word of God this morning. And we need to apply it. And we need to be those men and those women that God has called us to be. But first, God has to be our God. Because if not, you know, we go to church whenever it's foggy or too cold, or we can't live like that. And I pray that you would be encouraged, because we serve a God that is full of promises. That is the motive for our obedience, not just what we get in this world. Because we may spend most of our lives asking for stuff. You know what? We need to stop asking for stuff, and we need to relate. We need to know our Father. We need to know what he wants us to do. We need to make God our God. Verse 4 says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might." Why does Israel to this day still recite the Shema twice a day? You know, every morning and evening. This confession is so important to the Orthodox Jews that they require their children to memorize it as soon as they can speak. You know, I believe that we need to do the same, because we are drawn to the different gods of this world. Name it. You know, it is said, and I've heard it said many, many times, where you spend your most time, it is the God you serve. I mean, it's, you know, you think about that and it's like, whoa, man, you know, where am I spending most of my time? Don't even look at your phones, because your phones will tell you. Where we spend our most time, that is the God that we serve. So we need to go back to the Shema and recite it in the morning and in the evening. Why? Because we need to remember God needs to become our God. Because again, our heart is drawn by different things in this world, wealth, fame, or fortune, or any other activity that involves most of our time. That is the God we serve. We are commanded to love God, which is, it says in verse 5. We are commanded to love God. Is it possible to command someone to love? Isn't love a mysterious thing that just appears? Remember? All them butterflies and stuff? No, not for a Christian. No, not according to Scripture. In the life of a believer, love is an act of the will. We choose to relate to God in a loving way, no matter how we feel. Remember that. Because it ain't going to be, you know, feel good every day. There's some days we're going to feel really miserable. You know, I've always rest on Romans 8:28. All things work together for good. To those that love the Lord and have been called according to his purpose. Young, old, doesn't matter. It applies to all of us. It applies to every single one of us. So God commands us to love him. To love God, worship him, and serve him is the highest privilege that we can have. When God commands us to love, he's inviting us to do that which is best for us. Isn't that a book of do's and don'ts? His word is a love letter. You've heard it said before. And you, most of what I'm saying, you may have heard it before. But we all need to be reminded of what God's word is to us. We need to get excited for this. You know, I've heard it so many people, oh, Christianity is just boring. You know what? If your life is boring, you need to come and hang out with me. Oh, man, it's like, if anything can go wrong, it goes wrong. But it's what God uses to build us to his image. Amen. Remember the couch? You spend the night on the couch? There's a reason for that. Pride or whatever. God uses every circumstance in our lives to make us like Christ. Because something needs to be broken and fixed before it's broken, before it's fixed. Verses 6 through 7. It reads like this. Oh, we better put some mandala into it. 6 and 7. And these words that I command you today shall be in your heart, on your heart. You will teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your home, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your foreheads, that they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your household and on your gates. We need to use every opportunity to relate and to teach our children God's word. Every circumstance. The most natural moments happen throughout the day. When we go for a walk, activities, and when we tuck them in bed. There's a lot of opportunities. You know, in our home, every time I sit, now I'm down to the last one. The last of the Mohicans. Once he's out, man, I don't know what empty nesters look like, but it looks pretty nice. Anyways, so we take every opportunity in our home. We sit down at the dining table, and I've always done this, you know, even since before. Give me just 2 minutes of your time. Even when we did the bills, I sat all five of my kids, and one, you know, we started off with the smartest of the five, which I won't say because he may not be here. But he would start with a total amount that we had, and then we would grab that utility, and one would do the check. The other one would, minus from the, for whatever was in the principal. The next one would go down, and everyone had a part in it. Why did I do that? I wanted them to see God's promises. You know, this is back when we got paid $1.75 an hour. You guys remember that? You couldn't stretch it that much, but, I wanted them to see. Not only that, since then, it's been every day of my life. I make it a point to teach my kids, even from Joshua. Sometimes we sit so long at the table that I have to take an offering. It's like, dude, it's been already an hour. Here you go, God is so good. And I pray that we can see. That we can see that in our lives. And not only that, it's not just for you. It's for us to continue to pass it down to the next generations. So I pray that you guys would go out there and be the dads and the moms that God has called you to be. Because we are in such desperate need of that. So as the worship team comes up, I want us to pray. I want us to seek the Lord and be honest with them. Maybe you've been hiding out. Maybe we haven't been doing that which God has called us to do. I love that Paul uses a parental model in this communication with new believers. And it's, 1 Corinthians 2:10-12. You are witnesses, and God also How holy and righteous and blameless was our conduct towards you, believers. For you know how, like a father with his children, we exhorted each one of you and encouraged you and charged you to walk in a manner worthy of God who calls you into his own kingdom.